إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره، نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، شر الأمور محدثاتها فإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. I greet you all with the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and the blessing of Almighty Allah be with you all. I'd like to welcome you all for continuation of our series concerning tarbiyah, nourishment, fostering. And this constitute class number 46. There is a piece of paper about this size, Habib. I was writing on it. See if I left it on the desk, please. Today, inshallah, we're going to try to cover two issues. Due to my sickness, I don't think I can go for too long. Also give you opportunity that you catch your dinner before it gets cold. Those who may go to be blessed and eat dinner if they did not already eat them. Again, we're talking about mannerism, behavior, discipline, certain rules and regulations that we need to teach our children, and the way how we raise our children. Because this is the only hope for bringing about a better life, bringing about security and safety and happiness in this life as well as in the hereafter, is to go back again to the main source, to go back again to the Quran and the Sunnah, and see how the Sahaba, may Allah be pleased with him, had put it in action. And when we raise our children, our students, our future generation on this adab, now inshallah, that we will see the result will be a people of Allah, whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised them the good of this life as well as the good in the hereafter. With absence of the tarbiyah, all this what we hear about Islamic schools and Islamic university will be nothing other than filling mind with quotation and memorization parts, but the actuality is missing. The reality is not there. So again, the contribution is to try to revive these principles again, talk about it, because nowadays even most of the scholars, what they talk about rules and regulation concerning the basics of Islam, what breaks your wudu, what violate your fasting. But this adab, which is the daily behavior, we little bit that we hear about it. Today we studying with the tarbiyah على منهج أهل السنة والجماعة. This chapter 15, class number 46, and talks today about الاستئذان أو أداب الاستئذان. The proper behavior of seeking permission when you enter a place which is not yours, is not your personal home. Islam teaches us, all adult as well as the children, the proper way how to approach these places, regardless that we have relatives in it or we don't. When you approach a house, this house can be yours, or a house of relatives, or a house of non-relatives. How we supposed to act? We see the instruction of Almighty Allah in Surah An-Nur, verse number 27. Allah the Almighty is saying, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, la tadukhulu buyutan ghayra buyutikum hatta tastanisu وَتُسَلِّمُوا عَلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. We see that the verse starts with the nida, the calling on who? On the believers. All who you believe, since we adopt Islam, and we are pleased with Allah as our Lord. So Allah, our Lord means that He's your master. Is your boss, is the one who gives you direction, and that you have to do your best to listen and to behave according what he's saying to you. So he's reminding you that you are a believer. So say, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, oh you believe, la tadkhulu buyutan ghayra buyutikum. Do not enter any houses that is not yours. Your house is okay, but if it's not, is a house but is not yours, now this house, it can be a tent, it can be a trailer house, it can be one bedroom, doesn't matter how it built, how big, how small, how fancy. It's not your house. So there is special instruction how you approach it. Hatta tasta'nisu, until you have istinas, that you feel that you are welcome. Okay? Did not get into a house, they are not welcome there. And in addition to this, that you greet the people that in these houses, وَتُسَلِّمُوا عَلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. If you do not feel or you know that you are not welcome there, do not go there. Do not enter it. This kind of reception of feeling that you are welcome to visit or to enter or to be part of what is going on, you're supposed to be smart enough to know if you welcome there or not. And even if you got this, that the adab and the proper way that you greet the people of this house. We talked already last week about, or the week before, the proper greeting, which is not, hey, yo, good morning, all these things, no, but salam. So you're promising them peace, and you're making dua for them that they are remain in condition of security and peace, and you spread the greeting of as-salam. So this is one thing that we have to have this vibe, feeling that we are already welcome, that is okay for you to come, to visit, or to talk to the people. Okay? And before you enter, that you will get this greeting, and when you been permitted and welcome, now you enter. Otherwise, you are not supposed to enter this house. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in the same surah, Surah An-Nur, I think it's 27, verse number 59. And when the children reach the age of puberty, let them to seek permission, approval to enter, same way like those before them, they thought a permission. So when the child reach the age of maturity, now it became obligation on them before they enter the bedroom or the house of others, the bedroom in their houses, with their mother, their father, their stepfather or stepmother, that now there is a way to approach it. And said that al-atfal, children, that means there is a period of teaching, and now it's a period of putting what you've been taught in action. Let them seek permission, okay, before they enter. So it's not only coming from the street that you need to seek a permission. You can be living in the same house, but there is a room, and there is a privacy, and there is a certain time. Those children who did not reach the age of puberty, maturity, and this does not mean if he did not have a mustache or that he's not 13, 12 years old. No, it means a sense. This is something else also. They may be not mature, okay, in a sense, development physically, but in their mind already know about sexuality and excitement by what they see. Especially we're living in a time that is so serious that even a child that is maybe 7 years old already been introduced to many things. If it's not from the school, from the kids they hanging with, or from different scenes and things that they see on the TV, magazines, almost everywhere. And now, mashallah, astaghfirullah, that each one now walking with an iPad or phone 5 or whatever you call all these names. And wherever you go, internet, And Allah knows best what they see, what they watch. So now they are children, but the sensation already been developed in them. So now, even if they live in the house of the family, now there is a room and there is a door is closed. They could not open this door, all right, without knocking, without greeting, without seeking permission, especially in certain time when the parents take a nap or after Salat al-Isha when they go in privacy, okay, so that the children not to be surprised by any scenes that it may be destructive to them or it cause some problem to them. So this is the adab of the Islam. And we have to be very important to teach our children this. Even if your own daughter, because some people, they say, she's my daughter, I give birth to her. Yes, you are her mother, but now you could not see from her, neither she can see from you certain parts of your body. Because as example, your knees became part of your aura in front of your own daughter. You see, I give a birth to it, she's my daughter. Okay? He found maybe the daughter in the bathtub and the mother in the toilet seat and say, she's my daughter. Or she's my mother. Okay? Changing clothes in front of each other. This is Islamically wrong. Okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk about the zina, the adornment. Does not mean the zina that they could not see your jewelry, but the places where is the jewelry is where. This is permissible for your daughter. Like as example, you hang earrings so your daughter can see your ear, can see your head, your necklace, okay? But a woman's breast is not a place of adornment. You don't put a ring there or necklace there. So you find women wearing shorts, okay, and say, oh, we don't have any brothers in the house. We are chilling. Women in front of women, okay, or mother in front of her daughter wearing a short. There is nothing there. Place of adornment. Maybe ankle bracelet, this is a place of adornment. So it's okay. But above the knees, there is no adornment. At least now we came to see the society making adornments in every places. Okay? The navel, even in the private parts, wearing ears, wearing what you call ring. So what? Where is the limits? The limits according when the Islam been revealed, what the women used to wear in that time, this is the adornment, which is allowed for a woman to see from a woman, or a mother see from her daughter, or daughter see from her mother. So according the revelation in that time, this will be the gate closed after this. But if we say, no, the adornments, any place that a woman bought any something to beautify her body is okay. So that means a daughter will be seeing the mother private parts. Is this right? According to what's happening nowadays. All right? So it is very important for the children, boys and girls, to understand about the privacy, and they did not approach the house or the bedroom in a certain time and in certain occasions. And that the person always start with a salam to inform the people that you are coming or you are entering, or you ask if I can enter. But always the salam have to be given first before anything else. We see that one of the Sahaba approaches the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he entered to his house, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, go back, okay, and say assalamu alaikum, can I enter? Okay, you don't come and say hey mom or hey dad, it was brother. No, first from outside you say assalamu alaikum, may I enter? Okay, wa alaikum salam, yes you may come in. All right, so the greeting have to be recited first, then he's seeking a permission to answer, to enter. Also, if the person in the house doesn't know who this person and ask who's this, that you reply by giving your name. You don't say this is me, who's me? It can be anybody else, okay? It's me, who's me? Okay? Or to say, hi, who's this? Open the door. No, this is not the proper way. Islam says that you have to identify yourself when you've been questioned. And also that the person, when you go to visit or go to a house, seeking permission will be up to 3 times. Now, if you're seeking permission by ringing the bell, or by knocking in the door, or by calling the people of the house, you don't stay now for half an hour ringing and knocking on the door. You ring the bell 1 time, 2 times, or 3 times, or if it's a tent or a trailer house. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum. You didn't get any response, so you're supposed to leave. You don't insist. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us in hadith, which is the collection of Imam al-Bukhari, al-istidhan thalath, seeking permission to enter 3 times. So if they been permitted, you enter. Otherwise, go back. You leave the people alone. Say, yeah, but I know they are inside. They may inside, but they're busy doing something. Or they are disturbed with something. They don't want meet anybody. They don't want to meet guests. They don't want to understand, to be disturbed. Whatever it is, that for reason. I see the car in front of the house, so it doesn't matter, okay? So you know that they already heard you, and you did this 3 times, now you could not be bothering the people and insisting that they come to the door, you go back about your business. Also, from the adab and the proper discipline of seeking permission, that if you've been told to go back, you go back without any ill feeling or taking it against the people. So maybe assalamu alaikum, assalamu alaikum. So from inside, alaikum salam. This is Omar. Alhamdulillah, I'm sorry I could not see you now. I could not come to the door. I see you tomorrow. I'll be there in the mosque for Maghrib. Now you don't go to the whole community, look at this. What do you think he is? Okay? Drove all the way to St. Andrews, and after this, he told me I could not come to the door. This is the teaching of Islam. And we have to accept this thing and to be happy with it. This is the adab. This is the etiquette of Islam teaching us this. And not only to leave with a long face and go to talk about the person, but you have to take it good and go about it. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us this instruction in Surah An-Nur, verse number 28, وَإِنْ قِيلَ لَكُمْ ارْجِعُوا فَارْجِعُوا هُوَ أَزْكَى لَكُمْ. And if it's been said to you, go back, you go back. This is more purify for you, more perfection, more tazkiyah, purification of the soul. Okay? So you take it nicely and you go back with no ill feeling about your brother or your sister. Allah is telling us this. وَإِنْ قِيلَ لَكُمْ ارْجِعُوا فَارْجِعُوا. He did not come to the door and still behind the door and say, وَعَلَيْكُمُ السَّلَامُ, I'm sorry. Brother, I came all the way from Samtar. I'm sorry I could not come to the door. Maybe he's just fighting, you understand, him and his wife. Or maybe they have a good time, you understand, together. He's been away for a week, and after this he coming, he doesn't know when else he's going to be having time with his wife. So he said, I could not come to the door. This is it. Okay? And we have to accept it, the teaching of Islam, and to impose it in ourselves and to train ourselves that we have to bite it. Because Allah is saying to us, if it's been said to you, go back, you go back. This is more good for yourself. Also from the adab of seeking permission and approaching people's houses for visitation or whatever, that you don't stand in front of the house. Especially, yes, we have doors now, we have gates in front of the house, but some of the houses, like as example, the masjid door, you can see a glass in the middle of the door. So some houses, they have these fancy doors and they have glass, nice glass in there. So if you stand and you can see the people, you see his wife, you understand, in the house. We have to understand the purpose of seeking the permission. He did not see the awrat of the people of the house, how they dress, or how they acting, or whatever it is. So you don't stand in front of the door when you go home asking to visit somebody. You stand to the side, you ring to the bell, you understand, to the, because maybe even a child will run and open the door, and the mother is not covered, you see? So we have to understand when we go, we did not stand immediately in front of the door. Also from the adab that we choose the proper time for visitation. You don't go, alaykum as-salam, in a time that people usually taking a nap, or usually people went to their bed 10 o'clock at night, they ate dinner, they made Isha, they watch the news, and you know, 10 o'clock, they have to get up like 5 o'clock in the morning, get ready for the job and things like this. So you know, most of the people, 10 o'clock, they're already in bed, and you go 11 o'clock, knocking at the door. So we have to choose the proper time to go visit the people or try to discuss things with them. Also, we have to be considerate the way how we ringing a bell or knocking at the door. Some people, when they go to visit, they act as if they are deputy or a sheriff about to break the door. This is not the proper way. And the Sahaba, may Allah be pleased with them, been narrated that when they used to go knock in the door of the house of the Prophet ﷺ, they used to, with their nails, do it with their nails. Okay? So the knocking is not to be a means of disturbing. Maybe there is no people knocking these days, you ring bell, but you put your finger on the bell, okay? And you don't take it until people show up. This is not the proper way, okay? We have to be gentle, and we have to be kind and respectable. Subhanallah, all these things Islam teach us about it. We don't need to borrow anything from any civilization or any country or any culture, because Islam have it all. And not all and the best. The second discipline that we won't talk about tonight, inshallah, this will be the last. The proper way of gathering and sitting. We gather for Jum'ah, we gather for classes, we go eat dinner in people's houses, we sit for meetings and things like this. And you may remember last week, I had mentioned something about it. We notice that people, especially in majlis of ilm, learning the deen, we remember when Jibreel alayhi salam, the angel Jibreel came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, okay, فَأَسْنَدَ رُكْبَتَيْهِ إِلَى رُكْبَتَيْهِ وَوَضَعَ يَدَيْهِ عَلَى فَخِذَيْهِ. Okay, so there is a proper way to sit and a gathering, and so we need to discipline these things. I mentioned last week about people when they sit in Jum'ah, sit in classes, and how you understand this whole wall have three sisters and one sister by herself to the other side. We said what the Prophet said last week, that when the Prophet ﷺ went to rest area, okay, the Sahaba used to despair. Two here, three here, five there. So the Prophet directed them, gave them the proper instruction, and told them, you disperse between the mountains and in the roads is from the shaitan. Always shaitan try to keep us away from each other. And you see it even in the mosque, in Jum'ah, the lines in the front empty, people sitting in the back to lean against the wall, people sitting stretching their legs with no excuse. We understand people over 40, they have problem with their, okay, it's okay, acceptable. But you find little kids, 8 and 10 years old, sitting in front of the teacher, stretching their legs, or halfway laying in the class. This is not the discipline. And some people say, the kids, no, they are kids, but they are not kids. They are the future of Islam. We need to discipline them. We need to always keep eye on them. You don't give it to them only in talk. You keep eye on them when they sit. How they sit. How they supposed to be. Especially if older people there, or their parents there, or the sheikh is there, or they are in a majlis seeking knowledge and learning about Allah and the deen of Allah. So when Jibreel came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he folded his legs and he put his hands on his lap. Okay? So this is something very important to talk about it. And we're going to talk about a few things that we need to take it in consideration. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the Sahaba this, when they stop, they came so close to each other that if you both a cover, you can, like a bed sheet, it will cover all of them. Or if you bought a blanket, all of them, they will get so close to each other. This unity, bring about unity, solidarity, love, brotherhood and sisterhood, okay? But you found five people, big, huge mosque, almost like a half block. One is there and one is this corner, okay? And with the class, the imam sitting there, and the people all the way, taking a chair, taking a seat in the back, watching from a distance. This because the people are not been taught this. And if they've been taught this, nobody kept the eye on them to tell them, get closer, fold your legs, be beside each other. To such a degree, even in their prayers, they don't know how to stand together. And you find gaps between them. One of the things that we need to take it when we're talking about sitting, the selection of the place where to sit. This happened with the Sahaba, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, "Iyakum al-julus ala turuqat," because they did not have like we have executive meeting office, and we have conference room, and all these things. We designed different rooms for different purpose. And their houses is like one room, not one bedroom, one room. The Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, their houses, what you call it, the house, is one room, and this is it. Not one bedroom, that means you have a bathroom and a shower and a small hall and dining and a kitchen and the bedroom. They call it a studio nowadays. But the studio even much better, because basically if they use the bathroom, they go outside. And if they cook inside the same room where they sleep in it. They eat in the same room. It's like a four walls, if you can call it walls, okay? Very basic life. So where is the Sahaba when they have some discussion or like a shura meeting or whatever it is? They sit by the road. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam admonished them one day about not sitting by the roads, because the roads is a place people going and coming and back. They say, "Oh Prophet of Allah, we don't have any other place that we can gather and we discuss. We have certain things that we need to discuss it. If it's about our business or about the mosque or about the deen." He say, "If you have no other choice, okay, so give the road its right. Give it the proper behavior, the proper adab, how you interact with the road." He say, "What is the proper way to sit in the road?" He said, "Ghadd al-basar," lower your gaze, "Kaff al-adha," keep your harm. Keep your harm from the people. Don't harm anybody. All right? "Answer the salam of the person who greet you, and enjoy the good and forbid the bad." Because the road, the street, people going and back and forth. Now you're going to see this sister going to the mosque and this man going to the road, and they understand. So everybody going. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that, give the right of the road, the adab. And number one was what? Lowering the gaze. Okay, oh look this. What's he buying? What's he taking? Oh, this whose wife? And this who's, you understand? Lower your gaze. And don't harm the people, not by your tongue, not by your hand. The people who are going and coming and back. People read the salam and you return the salam. And if you see something evil, correct it. Okay? So we have to be selective in our gathering where we sit. All right? If we have to gather. When we sit, we don't sit in a mannerism that is forbidden or disliking Islam. All right? The time of the Prophet ﷺ, they did not have underwears. They have something like a towel, izar. They have rida and izar. They have like two pieces of cloth. One they wrap it around their waist, and one they cover themselves from the top. So if a person sit in a way that is not proper, that he or she may be, their private parts will be exposed. So they have to be very careful the way how they sit. All right? And also, people not to sit in a mannerism that is disliked or prohibited in Islam. As example, Brother Habib, do you want to put your hand behind you and lean in your... Exactly. Okay. No, not this one. This is two. Two hands is okay. But look. Look how Brother Habib sitting now. Okay. This is forbidden. All right? For to sit this way. Itikaf. Put in the right as a left hand behind you. Okay? And lean in the neck. And if I'm not mistaken, my memory doesn't help me now. 3 days more would be 66. Is it correct?
Yes.
You said 66. This by Kafir calendar, by Muslim calendar will be what, 72? So anyway, excuse me if I'm forgetting. All right? This is the sitting of the people of hellfire, of the people whom Allah angry with. All right? So you are not supposed to sit this way also. It's very important that we be selective. It's not only the place, how to sit and where to sit, but with whom you sit. This is something very important. Be sitting with the people, backbiting, slandering, eating the people's flesh. Okay? We have to be selective. The Prophet ﷺ had told us about the likeness of the good person you sit with and the bad person that you sit with. Jalis, the one you sit with, doesn't matter is he or she or they, whatever. A good company would be like the person who sells perfume. So by sitting beside a person who's selling perfume, you will smell something good, is it? Or he may give you a free sample. Say, try this, jasmine. Okay? I just got it from the rotten apple. Okay? Try this. Smell good. So he give you a free sample. Or you may like it and buy. So when you sit with the right people, you are not going to be hard. But he said, sitting in a bad company would be like the person who what? Blowing the furnace, the blacksmith. And now you will be smelling the smoke that coming out of the furnace. That you don't have fresh air anymore. You have corrupted or polluted air. Why? Because you are sitting there in the shop, which you understand molding and factoring the welding things, so smoke's coming. It's going to be bad for you. So this is the same way when you sit with people, bad company. You're going to be carrying sin. start talk about things, and after this, oh, sister so-and-so and brother so-and-so, this community, this, Imam is it, you understand? Yes. That you sit in the gathering that you enter to, wherever you find the empty place, you don't go and select, okay? Or asking somebody to move so you can sit. So we found a spot empty here, so we go to the empty spot. Not to go cross over the people like some people do in Jummah. Cross over the people's shoulders so they can go to the front line. If you want to be in the first rank, go early. But disturbing the Muslims by any means is not correct. Okay? And part of this disturbance that you come late, and after this you try to reach it to the front line. Also, from the adab and the proper discipline, which we need to practice and teach our children and raise our children with this adab, this discipline, that you do not separate between two people. All right? Salih is sitting and his father beside him, so they beside each other. All right? And now you come and try to wedge or get between them. This is not correct. If there is a space, this is a different story. But for you to try to come to squeeze between two people already sitting beside each other, unless you ask a permission, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, لا يحل الرجل أن يفرق بين اثنين إلا بإذنهما. It's not permissible for a man to separate between two without their permission. Excuse me, do you mind, because I need to ask the Imam a question, you understand? So now, because him and the Imam sitting, okay? So now by seeking permission, this is okay, but you come and squeeze yourself between the two, this is not acceptable. Also, it is forbidden, like we're sitting now, we're sitting in a circle. Somebody come and sit what? It doesn't sit here or here or here. He comes and sit what? In the middle of the circle. This is not from the adab. You don't sit in the middle of the circle. Okay? Because sitting in the circle, you will be disrespect for these people who are behind you. You're giving them your back. You see? And now you become like, I'm a special. Everybody sitting, but I'm here in the middle. You don't do this. It came in the hadith. It may have some defect in it. There's a Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, لعن الله من جلس وسط الحلقة. The curse of Allah is upon the person who sits in the middle of the circle. Also, when you come to a gathering and only two people there, you don't whisper to one of them in the presence of the third person. Okay? So now when I came to the Musalla, I found Umar and Yusuf. So now I come, you understand, and whisper to Umar in his ear. And Yusuf could not hear me. All right? This is not proper. Maybe the shaitan will make Yusuf think that I'm telling Umar something about him, or to do something to him, or whatever it is. Okay? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbids that we carry a whispering or private conversation when there is only two. All right? So you wait until another person will come, and now you can carry the conversation that we are now became four. But Yusuf and Umar and me, we are three. Now I get Yusuf to the side or get Umar to the side and start whispering to him. Doesn't matter what you're talking to him. Even if you don't, brother, let's come and make two rak'at together. Let's read Quran. But it's whispering. You see, you don't know what Umar, how he feel about it, okay? Or Yusuf, what you feel about it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, إِذَا كُنْتُمْ ثَلَاثًا فَلَا يَتَنَاجَى إِثْنَانِ دُونَ الثَّالِثِ مِنْ أَجْلِ أَنَّ ذَلِكَ يُحْزِنُ. If you are three, two of you could not be whispering to each other without the third. That means you want to talk, talk loud, that both of them will hear. But don't carry private conversation between you and one, and you leave the other person. The Prophet ﷺ saying, because this will sadden the other person. We have to take things in consideration. If a person departs from the gathering, like we're sitting now, okay? And Habib left, you understand, he got a phone call, say he left not to disturb, to answer the phone, he come back. Now we found Farouz already sitting in his place. Habib deserve and has right over his place because he was here and he stepped outside to refresh his wudu, to answer his phone, whatever it is. Now he has more right of this spot than Farouz or anybody else. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying in hadith, which is a collection of Imam Muslim rahmatullah alayhi, إذا قام أحدكم من مجلس ثم رجع عليه فهو أحق به. One of you depart from a majlis, a gathering, and return back, now he has right over it more than anybody else. Also from the adab and the proper way of majalis, gathering and sitting, that we try to give room for each other. So let's say, as example, that we here now, we have a full circle. Somebody else came. Instead of him sitting behind us, what we do, we open the circle, okay? So we can accommodate the person. Also in our gathering, we have to be careful with our tongue, what we talk about. This is part of the adab of the deen. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us about man kana yu'minu billahi wal yawm al-akhir falyaqul khayran aw liyasmut. Whosoever believes in Allah and the day of judgment, let him say something good or be quiet. And also one of the things that Allah doesn't like, qila wa qal wa kathrat as-su'al. He said, she said, okay, what it is, questioning people about things, you have no business, it doesn't concern you. So, and it is very important that we minimize our so-called socializing gathering as much as possible, because usually this kind of gathering, it bring about backbiting, slandering, unnecessary talk, you see, unless we mindful about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, enjoy the good, forbid the bad, and be mindful about what we do and what we say. There is something called fadl al-kalam, okay, that extra talk, extra time, extra of this. If you really want to get yourself together, this extra stuff, extra food, extra sleep, you try to cut it off. Like some people, they want to lose weight. Okay? Now they try to certain things. Even the tea, no more tea. And if they drink tea, now they have a decaf. Okay? Oh, we are not going to take bread and rice, all these things. But when it comes about their deen, all trash coming in. TV gathering, staying after, you understand, after Isha until 1 o'clock, and about what? Talk, about what? So this kind of gathering is going to be something against us in most cases, you see? And most of the gathering nowadays doesn't bring about brotherhood or sisterhood, it brings about dissension and disunity and problems in the communities, and things like even destroying families. It is very important that we avoid gathering which disbelieving in Allah or make fun and mockery of the verses of Allah or talking about Muslims being this and that, especially with the non-Muslims or even Muslims, okay? And this is a serious thing, unless you're going to be able to correct and to stop the people or depart from them. But gathering with people which is they did not show respect to the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially the gathering of the people of Bid'ah. So we have to sift, you understand, through our gathering, who and how and with whom and when and how, okay? Also it is from the adab of gathering that we don't stand up for the people who's coming in. This is something with back home culture. Every time, you understand, people gather for tea party or whatever, they don't party, but they sit, you understand? But every time one person come, everybody stand up as a sign of respect. And it would be more serious if the person deserves this, demands this. Okay, some people, if you did not get up, so bad, all right? So standing up for the people when they come in, there's no need for it, all right? Person come, greet, give salam to the people, it's fine. Other than this, there is no need for standing up for people when they entering. Also from the adab of gathering, that we enter the gathering, greet the people with the salam, and also that when we depart, we greet the people. So the greeting is not only when you enter. And we're talking about greeting and gathering in any place, whosoever, brothers or sisters. So what applies to the brothers, applies to the sisters also. So we don't say, you understand, to the sisters, okay, stop backbiting in your gathering or avoid this gathering of backbiting, but it's okay for the brothers. Same way we did not say salam alaikum when you enter the gathering and also say salam alaikum when you leave the gathering, does not only apply to the brothers, it applies also to the sisters, okay? It is very important that if you in somebody's company, that you seek permission. Allah asks us to seek permission when we enter houses. So don't let you understand your host go make you something in the kitchen and come back. You are not in the living room. You are not in the dining room. You are not anywhere. You look from, you understand, move the kitchen and look, your car is gone. This is not proper. You understand? You can seek permission to leave, to inform the person, and you seek his permission. He may did not finish discussing what he wanted to discuss with you, or that want to make sure that no of the family, you understand, uncover or sitting in the road before you step out, all right? So this is something that you seek permission the same way that we said in the beginning, then seeking permission to enter and the proper way. So there is a proper way also to exit. So you wait until your host will lead you, or he will tell you, yes, it's okay, you can go. It's very important that we remember kafarat al-majlis, expiation of whatever may is sin been committed in this gathering, okay? Due to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he used to end a gathering, he would say, Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Glory be to Allah with his praise. I testify that there is no deity worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I seek Allah's permission and return in repentance to him. Kafarat al-majlis, or means of expiation for a sins that been committed, and is something of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All these things and other maybe that I did not include for tonight are from the discipline that been taught by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and been mentioned also in the Quran. We need to take it in consideration. We need to learn it. We need to teach it to our children, our students in the school, and not only to teach it, but to monitor and keep eye to make sure that our children grow in this habit, in this practice, until it became part of their daily routine, inshallah, because this is the best behavior, and this is what is a part of the recipe to bring about a better future generation among the Muslims, inshallah. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. If anybody have anything to related to the subject that we talk about tonight, comments, correction or question, you may do it. Yes.
I have a question. You know when you go to the court and they say please stand, because like the judge,
they don't say please.
This is again. All right.
Yeah.
All right. So do you have to do it, or can you just?
Okay. Now you have a choice. You can do what the imam do, or you can do what the assistant imam do. Which one you want to do? The imam doesn't stand. The assistant imam is wait outside the courtroom until the judge come in, and after this, he will enter. So, and also not to start the trouble, you shouldn't be sitting in the front row, okay? So, which he would see you, and now he would take it against you. Oh, this is a different one. Yeah, but you don't stand because you have the shackle, okay? We're talking about the people who go to be a reference, okay, or that witness, all right? So he can go in the second, third row and basically said nobody even going to notice. He's not going to stand, okay? But I don't think this is a order or that you can be persecuted to this. I say, I think, I'm not a lawyer now, okay? But this been the culture or the practice of the people, but there is, to the best of my knowledge, there is nothing to say that you have to. Is it right, Chief?
I'm not a lawyer either.
Okay, this make two of us. All right, so, and also that nobody can tell you why you enter after the judge had entered. So this also can be more safe and secure, but for me, I don't stand. The sin will be on the person. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying in the hadith, which is the meaning is, من أحب أن يمثل له الناس وقوفا فليتبوأ مقعده من النار. Whosoever likes, okay, that the people stand up for him, let him have a seat in hellfire. So if became something that been imposed in you, or you have no other choice, the sin on the people, not in you, inshallah. The Allah knows best. Yes.
When you
you said about the piercings, right, and the places, is that permissible?
The piercing?
Is it permissible for a woman to get piercings other than her ears?
At least not to do with imitation for the non-Muslims. Because we know that these things been done in the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But is it part of deen or a part of culture, what you call, not culture, adat, habits? Because all the adat, the custom, okay, is permissible unless it conflicts with some of the teaching of Islam. And we see that the culture or the custom of the people nowadays extended so far. To such a degree, even people piercing parts of their bodies to private parts. So now if a person doing things, you understand, a woman doing things, beautify herself for her husband, out of her, what is known, you understand, the people like the ears, okay? This is okay, but to do it because the other kuffar women doing it, not to do it. Yes, and these things supposed to be done in with a child, understand, from early age, like for the ear, this is what is known, other than this, because it hurts also. And you are not supposed to inflict any punishment in yourself. So we said what is known to the time of the Sahaba, it can be done, extra can be done, unless that the person doing it to imitate the kuffar, this will be taken another angle, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And will be for women, but for, not for men. Men, you understand, allowed to have something like a ring, as example, from silver. But other than this, a man could not have an earring. So, and there is nothing that I know Islamically required for the man to pierce any part of his body. It's not been known in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Other than, you understand, for a man have a miswak and have a ring in his finger, I don't know anything else. Allah knows best. Yes.
Can you wear a watch?
Watch is okay. It's no problem. Now the watch, although that almost disappear, but now they have the watches that gives you the email and the camera and name it. But don't try to save your money for this now. It costs a lot. You have anything for tonight, Omar? Or anybody? Any tali from the Sheikh? Any correction?
Yeah, I got a question. About the ages for the women and the kids.
Like I said, it's not a matter of maturity that means they have a wet dream or that they pass their child. No, it's now about their exposure to what is going on, so he starts now to desire, and these things affect their body. Like I said, it can be even 7 years old. And now we could not be exposing the women in front of them, and they could not enter without seeking permission, because they already been corrupted according what they saw and what they heard and what they learned. You got it? Yeah.
When is the next Friday we're going to have the camp? The camp on Friday?
What camp?
Like when we used to have the fire.
What? Outside. I didn't remember I said anything about camp. What page is it?
No, I was talking about like...
Akhi, if the brothers, they want to make a camp, they're more than welcome. I need somebody to come and say, I'm here, I'm in charge, this is what I'm proposing, this is what we're going to be doing. Now, I'll give them the green light, inshallah. Other than this, I'm too old for camping and running kids until 3 o'clock in the morning, asking them, turn the iPad off and stop watching stuff. And if they come in here, you understand, only for haram fun or whatever, there's no need. They can do it in the house. Okay? So maybe you can talk to your grandpa and your father and your uncle. You have uncles also here. So in your family, you can start to get a group of brothers that can make a camp here. And you can propose it and we approve it. Doesn't matter if Friday or Sunday, it doesn't matter, inshallah. Anybody else? Any sisters, any brothers? Two, three, go for one, go for two, go for three, go for four. Right hand with this, okay. أعزكم الله خيرا سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك وما ملكت أيمانكم أستغفر الله نريد بعض